The Lord be with you.
And
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus taught his disciples, saying, "No one can serve two masters, for a slave will either hate one and love the other, or be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body or what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to the span of life? And why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Therefore, do not worry, saying, 'What will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear?' For it is the Gentiles who strive for all these things, and indeed your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given you as well. So do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring worries of its own. Today's trouble is enough for today." The Gospel of the Lord. So it seems that Jesus apparently was a hippie. You ought to know hippies, Father Mike, we must be saying by now. But he sure sounds like one in that gospel today, doesn't he? Don't worry about tomorrow. God will feed you. Just look at the birds of the air. Just be God's little flower children. Hakuna Matata. That would be Jesus' motto today. Do you know what Hakuna Matata means? What does it mean? No worries. That's right. Means no worries for the rest of your day. It's our problem-free philosophy, Hakuna Matata. Thank you very much, everybody. I love the fact that you always clap whenever I say, thank you very much, everybody, no matter what I've done. Just keep that up, okay? So Disney's going to sue me now. But what is Jesus saying here exactly? We don't need money anymore? Don't bother planning, quit your jobs. No, that's not what Jesus is saying. This is what he means. Sometimes I'll be finishing up my work day, unwinding after visiting 10 or 15 schools that day, something like that. I get home, I'm ready to relax, feeling perfectly happy, perfectly content with life, with everything. Putting my feet up, watching Survivor or Star Wars or something like that on TV, and then a commercial will come on, and before my eyes I see the Whopper. Sizzling, juicy beef grilled to perfection, about 2 pounds of meat. Biggest burger I've ever seen in my life. And in case the cholesterol from the burger doesn't kill me, it's got 8 strips of bacon sizzling on the top, calling out my name, Michael, Michael, Michael. And I wipe the drool from my face, and now I'm hungry. And then the next commercial is Best Buy. I love Best Buy. Gadgets and gizmos and toys, speakers and laptops and iPhones and Blu-rays, flashing and blinking and beeping with delight, telling me how easier and happier my life would be for only $8,299.99 plus GST. And I start thinking about buying a new iPhone. And then there's a life insurance commercial, and some famous celebrity, Charlton Heston, saying, "You work hard to provide for your family, But when you're walking out in the field tomorrow and a piano drops from the sky on top of you, and then shows you three little kids who are poor and starving, scared and hungry, wearing rags, Charlton Heston says, "Who will provide for your family then?" The answer, "We will." And it tells all they'll accept anyone without even needing a checkup. Says you can even start to enjoy your life insurance while you're still alive, like when you turn 55 or something like that. Then shows this old guy hugging his son who just graduated with a PhD, cured cancer, won a Nobel Prize, and walked on Mars all at the same time. And Charlton Heston finishes by saying, "Think about it. Think about the future. Do you love your children or not?" And the commercial ends with the sound of a piano crashing in the background. Clang! And I don't even have kids, but Moses just told me to buy life insurance. So I'm thinking about it. And the next commercial is the new Jeep Super Cherokee Turbo X50, and it's red. Oh, and it looks cool. And there's this average guy behind the driver's seat, and this really hot girl sitting next to him. And he's got this huge smile on his face, and I'm thinking, I think I need a new Jeep. Because I like red, of course, that's why. And they say it's no money down, no interest, no payments until the year 3000, so basically it's free. But this tiny little writing at the bottom of the screen is too tiny for me to read. And so, I start planning to visit Crosstown Chrysler the next day. And then, the next commercial is for, you see, Britney Spears, Jessica Alba, Brad and Angelina, Will Smith, Kermit the Frog, and Justin Bieber. All the most famous people in the world, singing and dancing and having a great time of the life because they're all drinking Pepsi. And they throw it back in one gulp and don't even burp while they're doing it. So of course, I reach over to my fridge, conveniently right next to my easy chair, and pop open a Pepsi, which I can do with one hand. And the next commercial is for a defensive driving course, so I change the channel. And remember how happy and content I was at the beginning of this commercial break? Now, 3.5 minutes later, I'm not happy at all. I'm restless, and I'm agitated, and I'm not happy. In fact, I'm not going to be happy until I have my Whopper, my new iPhone, my new life insurance policy, my new Jeep, and I've finished my Pepsi. What's happened? Well, what's happened is Burger King, Chrysler, Prudential Life, Apple Computers, and the Pepsi-Cola Bottling Company have spent millions of dollars on advertisers, psychologists, hypnotists, all to figure out how to make you and me think that we need what we don't need. To make us afraid that we won't be happy until we get what we don't need. Start fantasizing about it, planning for it, worrying about it. And then when we do get it, say we get that 60-inch plasma screen TV, then we have to get a surround sound system to go with it. And a Blu-ray player with PVR, and a satellite dish, and an insurance policy in case someone steals it, an extended warranty in case it breaks, and a bigger house because the TV won't fit in the other one anymore. And on it goes. We're never happy. We're never satisfied. Spending our lives endlessly chasing after stuff. And we worry about not keeping our jobs to pay for our stuff. Or the company closing, or the economy collapsing. Worry about what we're going to say to get the girl, to keep the girl. Worry about doing a good enough job. Worry about what happens if we get sick. Worry about everything. Worry, worry, worry. Stress. And to this, Jesus is simply saying, look, worrying is dumb. Worrying is useless. Waste of time. It accomplishes nothing. Won't add a single minute to our lives. Might even take a few away. Yeah, the world is crazy though, right? Chaotic stuff happening all the time. Worrying about it, well, we have to do some of that, right? But worrying about it's not going to change how crazy the world is. Money the price of oil, dealing with the in-laws, getting back to the football game, all the things we spend all day thinking about, obsessing over, trying to take control over our little universes. And because we're so busy paying attention to them, look at what we're missing. This is what Jesus is getting at. Look at what we're missing because we're so busy worrying. The lilies blowing with the wind. The birds singing their glorious song. That incredible sunset. The baby's first word. Father Mike's absolutely amazing homily. Because our minds are elsewhere. Stressed, worrying, pointless. Slavery. Yeah, I mean, you might be thinking, but what about this, Father Mike? Look at the poor. Look at the weak, the starving. Those are real. How can we not worry? And I'd have to answer, do you know what? The only reason that there are poor and weak and starving is because I'm too busy worrying about having enough stuff for myself, taking more care of myself and not passing it on. Not taking care of others, not sharing what I have. That's why there are poor. So instead, Jesus offers us an alternative. Instead of trying to take care of only ourselves, achieve only our own happiness, and in doing so, worrying ourselves to death, instead, why not just let God take care of us? Can we do that? Will God take care of us? Well, I've spoken before of my first car. It was my 1986 Hyundai Pony piece of junk. That's what it was called. That was the brand name, though. Hyundai Pony piece of junk. Instead of horsepower, it ran on hamster power. And I've had two names for it. One was the Gutless Wonder. That's what I called it when it worked. And when it wasn't working, well, I had another name for it, but I can't repeat it in church. It broke down so often that whenever it started making a new noise, like I'd be driving down the road and it'd start making, the passenger with me would just say, "Hey, Mike, what's that sound?" "That sound? Well, that's the sound of $350 falling out of my wallet." That's what that sound is. So then I went into the seminary. Money got really tight because I'm not allowed to have a job when I'm in the seminary. And I needed to keep the car running because I had to get out for ministry. I wanted to be able to see my friends. The seminary was out in St. Albert at that time, so it was out in the middle of nowhere. Not that St. Albert's the middle of the nowhere for anyone who lives there. It's close to St. Albert. So like a good seminarian, I was stressed about this, you know. I needed to keep that car running. I needed the money to keep it going. So like a good seminarian, I prayed to God. I said, "God, please let me have $10,000. So that I can keep the car running, or better yet, get a brand new car." And God answered my prayers. He said no. But God did give me just enough to get by. For example, I'd get a $200 bill for the carburetor for the fourth time. But just after that, I'd get a check for $250 from the Knights of Columbus. Huh. Or just after getting $100 from my home parish, for no reason at all, just because they like me, I'd have to flush the radiator for $110. Things like that happened all the time. Or sometimes the car forced me to ask for help, to ask somebody else for a ride. That was hard for me, but it sure was good. Good for me. And it still happens, of course. A few summers ago, I had a flat tire. I asked a parishioner for help, and I got a steak dinner out of it. What a great deal. That's a miracle. God loves steak. And by the time I got rid of that piece of junk, and it was a piece of junk, I learned to trust God, at least where money is concerned. There are other areas I still need to work on trusting God, like time, energy, my health. And God will continue to work on me with those. But where money is concerned, I can see that He has taken care of me. And I believe He will continue to do so. Not giving me what I want, just what I need. My daily bread. I've even learned to trust him enough to give some of what I don't need to somebody else who does. That's what that seeking first the kingdom of God is all about. That's what I think Jesus means. Hakuna Matata. No worries. God will take care of us because God loves us. Don't worry. God is love. Amen.